Good morning to all the students. So in the last class we have gone through some of the concepts in object oriented programming such as the access specifiers. How many access specifiers we have?
Three
access specifiers.
Three,
sir.
What are those?
Private, public,
private and protected.
Okay. Can anybody tell me what a protected access specifier will do?
It is almost the same as private, but it require the values can be accessed by subclasses. The objects can be accessed by subclasses.
Yeah, it's not the objects. No, it is the members of the superclass can be accessed. The protected members of a superclass can be accessed by the child class. Right. Okay, right. Super. So in today's class, we will start our discussion with member functions, right? Defining member functions. What is a member function? What is a member function?
The code of a class.
Yeah, the function which is present inside the class is called as member function, right? So we have a class like this, class, class name, and within that we have the data members, and then we have member function, right? So till now we have seen, for example, if you take an example like get x function or get y function, or similarly we have put x function or put y function. All these functions we have given the declarations inside the class, right? Do you know the difference between a function declaration and function definition? We have two terminologies related to function. One is the declaration of a function, which is also called as the prototype of the function, and second one is called the definition of the function. I think you have already gone through these concepts in the C programming language. So the declaration means it just gives the prototype of the function. That means it will tell the name of the function, it will tell the return type of the function, and it will also tell the number of parameters that the function is accepting and the type of parameters that the function is accepting. Right. So that is just giving the information related to the function is given by the function declaration. So what do you mean by function definition? Function definition is where we will define the function. That means where we will write different statements that will constitute the function. That means we will give instructions to the computer to perform a specific task. That is called as the definition of the function. So is it clear about the declaration part and definition part?
Yes.
Let us go with one example. Let us have a task of adding two integer values. Two integer values and display the result. This is the task I was given. So there are two things. The first thing, let us go with the first one, that is definition. So I take the function like this. It is the return type. Void is the return type. And let me take the function name as add. And since it has to add two integer values, I will take two parameters of type integer. And the variable names, I'm giving them as.
बाबू दिन
राइट. सो द वॉइड स्पेसिफाइज द रिटर्न टाइप ऑफ द फंक्शन, and add specifies the name of the function, And similarly, we have two parameters that are accepted by this function, and both the parameters are of type integer, and let us name them as x and y, right? And I'm saying that simply one statement, printf result is equal to percentile d, and I'm giving it as x plus. So how many statements are there inside this function?
One statement.
Only one statement, that is printf, right? So from here to here, from this point, we call this as the function definition. So by going deep into the discussion of the function definition consists of two parts, that is function header, and the second one is function body, right? So the first line of the function definition specifies the header. So the function header consists of the return type, the function name, and the number of parameters along with the data type. And the function body starts at the opening curly braces and ends at the closing curly braces. So between these curly braces, you can write any number of statements that can constitute the function definition, right? So a function definition is again divided into two parts. One is the header and the body. Header means the first line, which specifies the return type, name of the function, and the number of arguments along with the data type. And the function body specifies the statements that constitute the function, or the statements that perform the task is called as the function body. And these statements are included inside the curly brace. So this is the function definition. Actually, whenever you call a function, the function definition has to be invoked. Right. So what about the declaration? Declaration means the first line. Here I have divided the definition into two parts, that is header and body. So the header can be given as the declaration of the function. So when I want to declare this function, how I can write? You simply write the header part. What is the header I have? Anybody please tell me, what is the header? Void add
void int x
int x comma
int x and int y, and it should end with a semicolon, right? The function declaration should always end with the semicolon. As I told that the function declaration gives the information related to the function, like the return type of the function, the name of the function, and the number of parameters of the function, and the data types of those arguments also, right? So this particular information will be given by the function declaration. So you should know the difference between the function declaration and the function definition. Function definition is the actual, includes the actual statements which can perform the task, but the function declaration does not include any statements related to the function, but it only includes the header of the function, which specifies or which gives information related to that function. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes.
Right. Now, when we want to define the member functions, what do you mean by that? Is it this part or this part? Defining means. Let us take this is one and this is two. So definition of the function means we are
second
going
one,
to
sir.
The second one, right? Which is more sir. Important? Is the declaration is more important or the function definition is more important?
The definition,
sir.
Definitely, right? The definition is very important. Why? Because what actually you are doing by using that function is specified inside the function definition. So definition is more important than the declaration, right? But as I told that the declaration only gives the information about the function. It may be necessary in some cases and it may not be necessary in some cases. So declaration is an optional thing. but the definition is a mandatory. Why? Because whatever we want to perform, that is defined inside this function definition only with the help of the instructions. So how do in general we have seen previous examples where we are declaring the functions. So we are writing the functions in this case in such a way. This is the manner we are following for the function declaration, right? But actually, whenever we want to do some task, we have to tell the computer or we have to give some instructions to the computer. Those instructions are specified inside the function. So we need to define the function, the member functions of the class, right? So how we are going to define the member function? There are two ways. One is within the class. Within the class, you can define the function, or you can define the function outside the class also. So inside the class, you can define, or outside the class also, you can define. So within the class or inside the class, the definition of a member function within the class is similar to that of the function definition. Nothing to write, right? You just give the statements as it is, use in the same manner as you specify the instructions for defining a function. No more changes, nothing is there to change, right? But when we define the function outside the class, we should follow some syntax that we will see. Right, is it clear? How many ways are there to define the function?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
How many ways are there to define the function?
Two ways, inside and outside.
Two ways, sir.
Super. Yes. Inside the class and outside the class. When we define a function within the class, you write the definition of the function as if you are writing the definition of function in the C programming language. But when we specify the function definition outside the class, you should specify to which class the function belongs to. Right? For example, assume that add is one function that I am having. Right? I have given it as a member function of a particular class. I can give the definition inside like this, or when I go outside the class, I should specify to which class this add function belongs to. So I should have one special operator to specify which function or which class the function belongs to. That is called, we'll see that, all these things, right? So there should be some special syntax to identify the class of the function which we are defining, right? Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Simple concept, Amma. This is very simple. Defining member function, as we know that a member function of a class is a function that has its definition or its prototype. What do you mean by prototype? What do you mean by prototype? Just now I have given that statement. What is the other name for the prototype?
Function header.
Function.
No, it's not function header.
Function definition, sir.
Model.
Function definition is different from the function prototype.
Model, sir.
So if you go back to the previous slide, functions have two things. One is the declaration and the second one is the definition. Definition means it consists of two parts. One is the header and the body. So the declaration of a function is otherwise called as the prototype of the function. Is it clear now?
Yes, sir.
So a member function of a class is just a function that has its definition or its prototype. Right, we know what a definition is and we know what a prototype is. Prototype is otherwise called as
declaration.
Super. Right, declaration. Right. So if the member function of your class is nothing but a simple function where we may have the definition of the function or we may have the prototype of the function. Right. So it operates on any object of the class of which it is a member and has access to all the members of a class for that object. As we have discussed that even though you define or you declare the class, you define the class, memory will not be allocated for the class. The memory for a class will be allocated only when we instantiate it. That means only when we create an object for that particular class, then only the memory will be allocated. So in such case, when you create an object, whatever functions we have in the class or we have declared or defined inside the class. So have you understood the difference between the declaration and definition?
Yes, sir.
So when I say declaration, you should always remember the first line, that is the header of that function, that is, which includes the return type, the name of the function, the number of arguments and the data type of those arguments, right? But when I say the function definition, you should include both the things, which is nothing but the function header and the function body also, right? So whenever we declare an object for a particular class, then you have the functions for all the objects, right? So whatever functions you have in the class, those functions belong to that particular object. And what is the operator that is used to access the members of a class using objects? What is the operator that is used to access the members of a class using objects?
Dot operator.
Super, right, dot operator. So may I know the syntax? What is the syntax for accessing the members of the class? Dot operator is correct, but how? What is the syntax? What should be preceded the
name dot member?
Object name dot super member name. So this is how we access the members, whether it can be the data members or the member functions. We will use the dot operator to access either the data members or the member function, and it should be preceded with the object name, right? Is it clear up to this point? And there are two ways to define a member function, as we have discussed. One is the inside class definition and the second one is outside the class definition, right? We will see these two things with an example. So here you can see, what is the name of the class? Let us go with this example.
Box.
Now the name of the class is box. So how many public members are there? How many private members are there? And how many protected members are there?
Three public members,
sir.
Okay, what are those three public members?
Length, breadth and height.
Okay, what about this get volume?
That's a member function.
Super, it is a member function. And what is the scope of this member function? Scope means nothing but the access specifier. It is also public, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Right.
Now, what is that we are doing here? We are defining the function, right? Till now we have seen only the declaration part inside any class, but now we are defining the function within the class itself. So what is the name of the function we have?
Get volume.
Get volume.
What is the return type of that function?
Double.
How many parameters it is accepting?
Zero parameters.
So why it represents nothing, right? And what is the statement we have here? It consists of only one statement, that is return of length into breadth into height. What is this length, breadth and height?
Volume, sir.
No. It is the formula for volume, but what is this length, breadth and height?
Data members of the function.
Super. Not the function. These are the data members of the class. Right. So this particular function will return the product of the length, breadth and width, breadth and height. So when we call this function. So let us see how we can access these members. How we can access these members? So from this point to this point, from this point to this point, it represents the definition of the get volume function. Right. Now, if I want to access the length member of the class box, how can I access it? It's a simple question, Amma. Don't get confused. How can you access the members of a class?
By creating an object.
By creating an object and by making use of the dot operator, right? So you create a object called object for box class. What is the syntax for creating the object? You should have the class name followed by object name. So what is the name of the object that I have created here? Box one. So box one is an object of class box. Now I want to access. So what happens when I instantiate this box with box one? Whatever members that you have defined inside the class box will belong to this box one. So one memory will be allocated for length of this box one. Similarly, another memory will be allocated for breadth of this box one. And similarly, one memory will be allocated for height of box one. And similarly, you have a function for get volume for this function box or for this object box. So if I declare another box, another object box two, this is very important now. Please concentrate. So if I declare another object box two, so box two is an object of the box. What happens when I instantiate this one? Memory will be allocated. So memory for what parameters or what metrics will be allocated? So this box two will have all the members of the class. So this box two will have a separate memory location for length, and it will have separate memory location for breadth. Similarly, it will have separate memory location for height, and it will have separate definition for this get volume. Not separate definition, it is separate memory allocation. Is it clear up to this point? So like this, any number of objects you create for the class, that much of memory and those many members will be allocated for each and every object, right? Now I write like this, box one dot length is equal to 10. Is it correct or does it raise any error?
Correct.
Is it correct or not? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Why it is correct? Can I access the members of a class directly by using the object?
Yes, sir, due to public access specifier.
Super. Right. Since the length has been defined under the public scope, they can be accessed directly by the object. But if I declare this one as protected or private, now can I access them like that?
No, sir.
No, this is not possible. So whenever you declare the members under the public scope, you can access those members using the function or using the objects, right? Now I declare like this, box one dot breadth is equal to, again I will take it as 10. And then I write like this, box one dot height is equal to, again I take the height as 10. Now I am calling the function, right? Cout volume is equal to, I'm giving some space like this, and I want to call, in order to calculate the volume, I have already defined a function inside the class, that is get volume. So how can I access that function? how can I, for example, if you go to this statement box 1 dot length, so here the length will be assigned 10 and breadth will be assigned 10 and height will be assigned 10. So if I want to axis or the calculate the volume of this box 1, I have already defined one function called get volume inside the class box. So how can I access that particular function? It is by making use of the object that is box 1 dot get volume. So if you write like this, the get volume function of box 1 will be invoked. So it will calculate the length into breadth into height and it will return. So it will return a value of 1000. So I will get the output as volume is equal to 1000. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
This is how we define the function inside the class. Now, how do you define the function outside the class? This is important. Please concentrate. Right. So, whenever you want to define the function outside the class, you should specify to which class the function belongs to. So, there exists an operator, a special operator called as scope resolution operator. This is called as scope resolution operator. Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
So, scope resolution operator is nothing but a sequence of two columns. So, the scope resolution operator is used to specify to which class the function belongs to when we define the function outside of the class. Right. Now, let us go with the same example. See here. What is the name of the class? It is box. Again, I am defining three public members. One is length, breadth, height, and all of them belong to the double data type. And what is this one? Can anybody tell me? Is it the function definition or something else? If it is something else, what is it?
Function declaration.
Super. Right. It is function declaration, or it is also called as
prototype.
Super. Prototype. Function prototype. Right. So we have not given any definition inside the class. Now I want to give the definition outside the class, right? So what you will do is, this is the syntax for defining the class outside the, for defining the function outside the class, right? So the same thing here, as it is, you will be writing like this, double, and you leave some space and you give the name volume. And you give the parameters like, right? But you should tell the compiler to which class this particular function belongs to. Therefore, you have to use the scope resolution. And you have to tell to which class it belongs. What is the name of the class we have? It is box. So this is the syntax for defining a function outside the class. Only this scope resolution operator preceded with the name of the class is the extra thing you have to add, nothing more than, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. So whenever you define the class, you define the function outside the class, the only thing you have to tell the compiler, or only information that you have to give to the compiler, is to which class it belongs to. So that is specified before. That is specified by using the class name followed by the scope resolution operator. So the name of the function should be preceded with the class name and the scope resolution operator. Or you can say like this also. The class name and the scope resolution operator should be inserted between the return type and the name of the function. That's it. And the remaining statements that constitute the function definition should be written as it is. No change. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, in order to access these member functions or member data members, I know that I have to create an object, right? Let me create an object for box of box 1. And now, can I access this one? Member function, as you can access it. by making use of object name dot the name of the function. Right? Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Right. So we will extend this concept with one programming example. So hash include IO stream, and this is the definition of the class from here to here. What is the name of the class? Box, and I have public members like length, breadth, and height belong to double data type. And what about this one? What are the functions that I have defined inside the class? Get volume is one function. Set length is one function. Set breadth is another function, and set height is another. So I have defined. Is it the definition or declaration?
Declaration.
So I have declared. I should not say defined, right? So I have declared four function declarations, and the syntaxes are like this. So when I want to give the definition of get volume, I should say to which class it belongs to. That is done by using the class name followed by the scope resolution operator. So this is how I am writing. Double is the return type of the function. Box, scope resolution operator, specifies to which class it belongs. Therefore, get volume function belongs to box class. And then you write the statement. Similarly, set length is the function name, and this set length is a function which belongs to box. That is the reason why I am specifying it as box scope resolution operator. And void is the return type, and I am specifying, or I am just assigning the value that is given by the user, right? How many parameters it is accepting? Set length,
one
parameter, that is length of type double. So whatever value that is given by the user, I am just assigning that value to length. What is this length here? It is the data member of the class, right? Now similarly, I have defined the set breadth and set height of the definitions of the set breadth and set height, similarly as we have done for the set length, right? Now in the main function, coming to the second part, in the main function I have declared two objects. One is box one and another one is box two. So when I declare the objects for this class, what happens? So box one will have the members as length, what are the other members? Breadth and height. Similarly, it also consists of the different data function, member functions like get volume. Similarly, it also has another function called set length, and it also has another function called set breadth, and another function like set height. Okay. Similarly, for box two also, we have different data members: length, breadth, and height for box two, and get volume, set length, set breadth, set height functions for this box. Now, what is this particular variable? Does it belong to any class, or is it a different variable? Is it a separate variable, or does it belong to any class? What is this statement doing here? Double volume. Anybody please tell me, please respond.
Class, sir.
Now, what is this double volume is equal to 0.0? Now, what is int A? What is int A? What happened? Why you are not responding?
Declaration
of a variable A of type integer. Similarly, tell me, what is this double volume?
Declaration only, sir.
Is also a declaration. What is the variable name?
Volume.
Why you are getting confused? What is the data type of volume?
Double, sir.
Double. And I am assigning it an initial value of 0.0. It is a double. So tell me whether it is a declaration or initialization.
Initialization.
Initialization, sir.
So the declaration followed by the assignment or assigning an initial value at the time of declaration itself is called as initialization. So I have a variable like this and volume and it is 0.0. So box 1 dot set length, I am calling the function set length that belong to box 1. And set length, as we have seen in the definition, it accesses one parameter of type double. So I have given the value of 6.0. What is this set length is doing? This 6.0, this function is invoked and it is given a parameter of 6.0. So 6.0 is assigned to length of which object? What happens when we
think
this? Right, tell me. Why 6.0 is assigned to length of box 1. Super. Right. Similarly, what happens when you execute this statement? Box 1 dot set breadth of 7.0. So set breadth function of box 1 is invoked with a value of 7.0.
7.0
is assigned to
breadth, sir.
Breadth of box one. Right. That point you should understand. What happens when you execute this statement? Box 1 dot set height of 5.0. So set height of box 1 is invoked with a value of 5.0. What sets the value of height to 5.0? What is height of box 1 is assigned 5.0. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now what happens at this point? So I am invoking the set length of box 2 object and it is having an initial value of 12.0. So at this, the function will be executed and 12.0 is assigned to length of
box 2, sir.
Box 2.
Right. Similarly, here 13 will be assigned to breadth of box 2, 10 will be assigned to height of box 2. Now volume is equal to box 1 dot get volume. What does this statement do? It will invoke the function get volume. So it will go and execute the get volume function. So get volume is return length into breadth into height. So what are the values of box 1 here? Length, breadth and height.
So it is 6 into 7 into 5.
It's the value?
210.
210.0. You should write that.
Yes,
so
sir.
That value will be returned and it is stored inside this volume.
Yes.
The volume of box 1 is equal to 210.
Yes.
Finally, what happens to this statement? Volume is equal to box 2 dot get volume. So get volume function of box 2 will be invoked. And it will perform the multiplication of the second parameter. What is this one? 12 into 13.0 into 10.0. What is the value? Ma?
1560.
Super. This is how the function is executed. So have you understood how we have to define the function outside the class?
Yes, sir.
It is almost similar to that of defining a function, but you should, since you have to specify to which class it belongs. We have a syntax called the class name followed by the scope resolution operator. That we should include it in between the return type and the name of the function. If you do that, that is how we define the function outside the class. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Clear, sir.
So before we discuss this overloading of number functions later, once we complete this concept of nested classes, that it is also a very simple concept. We'll complete this, and if time permits, we'll discuss the overloading of member functions. Otherwise, if the time is not sufficient in today's class, we have a separate concept or we have a separate topic on overloading. Right. So at that time, we'll discuss how to overload the member functions on. So right now, we will discuss the concept of nested classes. Have you ever heard of this term nested in C programming?
Yes, sir.
Where, at what point you have come across this term nested, Amma?
Loops and structures.
Okay, nested structures you might have heard. Similarly, nested loops you might have heard, right? What do you mean by nesting in C?
Repeating.
It's not repeating. Nesting. What do you mean by nesting?
One inside the other.
Super. Right. So if you define one thing inside another thing, it is called as nesting. So if I say nested for loop, so I have a for loop int I is equal to 0, I less than 10, I plus plus. Right. So nesting means you have to define another for loop inside this for loop. So I write like this. For j is equal to 0, j less than 10, j plus. So if you define or if you declare one for loop inside another for loop, that is called as a nested for loops concept. So this nesting can go to any depth. Right. You can write any for loops within another for loop. Right. For k is equal to 0. K less than 10, k plus 10, right? So these concepts are called as nesting in C. So whenever you include one thing inside another thing, another same thing, then those things are, that is called as the nesting concept. So what do you understand by the term nested classes? We know what is a nesting, what nesting is. Now I'm just asking you a simple question. What is nested class?
Class inside a class.
So box. Right. So one class inside another class is called as nested class. That's nothing more than. But you have to create the object. So if you have one class, there is a direct syntax for the creating the object, right? What is the syntax for creating the object of a class? For example, assume that the class is XYZ. So I take the class name and then I give the object name like this. This is how you create or you define or you declare the object for a particular class. But when we have one class inside another class, how do you define or how do you declare the object for the inside class? This is what we should know. If you know that particular concept, then everything is similar to that of class. Right. So a nested class is a class that is declared in another class. That is what we have discussed. Right. Nested class means one class declaration inside another class is called as nested class. And then the nested class is also a member variable. Right. Till now we have seen what does a class consist of. What is a class consist of?
Class name, fields,
class name. We have member data members and
member functions.
Right, these things we know. Right, but now we are adding one more important concept. That is, we are adding a class inside a class. If you give some class name and then you write it. So when we define or when we declare a class inside another class, this class becomes the member of this class, right? So this is called as the outer class and this is called as the inner class. So the inner class becomes the member of the outer class, right? So this is called as enclosing class or outer class, we can call it, nothing wrong in it, right? And the class which is defined or declared inside another class is called as inner class, right? So the nested class is also the member variable. This is the nested class, inner class. So the nested class becomes the member variable of the enclosing class. This is enclosing class. We call it as outer class, and this is called as inner. And has the same access rights as the other member. What do you mean by access rights? What do you mean by access rights? Now please respond. What do you mean by access right?
Can access the data.
There is a simple term, Amma. Access rights are nothing but access specifier. Right. So public, private, and protected are the three access specifiers we have in object-oriented programming. Right. Similarly, the access specifiers are also called as access rights. So access rights are nothing but public, private, and protected. So if I declare the class under the public access specifier, the class becomes public. If I declare the class, the nested class, using the private access specifier, the class becomes the private member of that class. Similarly, if I declare the class, the nested class, using the protected data member, it becomes the protected member of that class. That is what he is saying. Simple thing, right? So once you declare a class inside another class, that class should also be treated as a member. And so whatever access rights you are specifying in the class, that will be applied to that class also. This is what he is trying to say. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. See here, this is very, very, very important. However, the member functions of the enclosing class. What do you mean by enclosing class here?
Outer class.
Class. It is outer class. So the member functions what we declare for the enclosing class have no access to the members of the nested class. So whatever members we declare inside the nested class cannot be accessed by the member functions of the outer class. So this is very, very important. You should keep it in mind. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes, sir.
The author is trying to say that the member functions of the outer class can access the members, data members of that outer class only. But whatever data members we have inside the nested class cannot be accessed by the member functions of the outer class. So outer class member functions can access only outer class members only, data members only. Outer class member functions cannot access the members of the inner class. That is what he is saying. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Right. We will see a simple example, very, very simple example. So in hash include Iowa stream. So class, what is the name of the class he is defining here? He is declaring here?
Yes, sir.
So he has opened an access specifier called public, right? Within this public scope, he is defining one class. What is the name of the class?
B, sir.
Class B.
So from here to here is the declaration of class B. So what are the members of class B? We have a private data member called num of type integer. And we have public functions. We have two functions, get data and put data. Two public functions, right? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now what is the need for declaring this get data and put data? The need for get data and put data is to get the data from the class B. Class B and put data is to put some data or output the data that belongs to class B. So what is the scope or what is the access right of this num?
Private.
So can it be accessed outside the class?
No, sir.
No, sir.
So in order to access the private members, you should have the member functions that belong to the same class, and that too one important point, and that too those member functions should be specified under public scope only, right? So if you specify this get data and put data under private scope, then nothing you can do with the private data, right? So as I told that one important point while discussing the previous concepts, I told you that it is in general you have to declare the data members under private scope and the member functions under public scope. This is what you have to follow. Is it clear? Members, yes, data members should be under private, member functions should be under public. Right. So we have one private member called num, and in order to access this num outside the class, you have to declare the functions called get data and put data, and they should be defined under the public scope. Right. So what get data is doing, it is taking a value from the user and it is assigning to the private member. And what put data is doing, it is simply displaying the value of the private member, right? So from and after closing the declaration of the class B, I am just closing the class A also. So does the class A has any members by its own data members?
No, does sir. Class
A have any data members? No. Does class A having any member functions?
No, sir.
No. So class A does not have any data members and it does not have any member functions also. The only thing it is having is a class that is declared inside class A. So and that too it is declared under public scope. So what is the scope of class B here? What is the scope of class B? So you should see the label under which the class has been declared. Class B has been declared under the label public. So the class, entire class becomes public. But the members inside the class are remains as it is in under which it has they have been declared. So num is a private member of class B and get data and put data are the public members of class B. But class B is a public member or public class, member class of this class. Now let us go to the second part, which is main. So I have created, now how can I create an object for A?
Dot operator, sir.
Now how do you create an object for A, class A?
Yes.
So it is simple, class name followed by object name, that's it. Is it right or not?
Yes,
now I want to create an object for B. So I know how to create an object for B. B followed by B. So B is an object of B. But this class B is declared under which class?
Class A.
So I should specify that this class B belongs to class A. So in the previous session or in the previous topic, we have discussed that whenever we want to identify which to which class the function belongs to, we have a separate syntax using scope resolution operator, and you have the class name. The class name followed by the scope resolution operator resolutes the scope of B. Right. So I should specify that B belongs to class A. So I should write like this. Simple. Is it clear after this point?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I have to create an object. So in order to access this get data and put data, can I access it using A?
Yes, sir.
Can I access it using A? Please respond, Amma. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
See here, what is the last point he is saying? the member functions of the outer class have no special access to the members of the nested class. So whenever you have some member functions outside in the outer class, we cannot make use of those member functions to access the members of the class. So we cannot access the members of class B using class A. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. But I have a doubt here. I have a doubt. Right. So this particular problem, you have to give me the answer in tomorrow's class. So can I have declared a function, a object for A like this, A space A, and now I want to access A dot get data. Will it work or not? You please try it and you get me the answer tomorrow. Is it clear?
Okay, sir.
You should create an object for the outer class and you should try to access the member functions of the inner class using the outer class object. Right. So coming back to our again discussion, our discussion of interest. That is, I have created B as an object of class B, but since B, the class B is declared inside class A, I should tell the compiler that this class B belongs to class A. So I am using the syntax A scope resolution operator B space B. So by this, the compiler will come to know that B, the user is asking to create an object B that belongs to class B of B, and again this B belongs to class A. Now I want to access the get data, so I can access it by using B dot get data, and since get data is accepting one parameter, I'm giving it as name, this one. So what is the name of the object he is creating here? OBJ, right? And OBJ belongs to, is an object of B, and B belongs to the class A. So OBJ dot get data of 9. Whenever the compiler comes across this statement, it will invoke the function get data of OBJ that belongs to B. So, and it is assigning a value of 9 to this num. And after that, I am calling another function OBJ dot put data. So it will invoke the function put data, and that will print the output as the number is num. What is the value of num here?
9, sir.
9. 9. 9.
So, number is 9. That is the output we get. Right. So this is the end of today's session. So in tomorrow's session, you should tell me whether I can access the inner functions or the member functions of the inner class using the outer class object. You should verify this one and you should tell me the answer. Right. Is it clear up to this point?
Yes,
yes, sir.
So this is the end of today's session. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir.
Right. Thank you.